come together this morning. I'm just going to open with a scripture, and we can pray, and we're going to sing songs. Pastor Tom is here and going to share a message with us. I'm going to open with Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. And that scripture humbles me. It brings to my heart that God loves me and wanted to save me. And it just humbles me that we can come before Him today and worship Him together. So let's, if everybody wants to come forward, we can get started. And everybody can join in with us.
Take my place.
thank you, God, for your grace that you've had in our lives, Lord. We thank you, Father, that you pour out your grace upon us, God. Thank you that we need you, God. And we come before you this day together, Lord. We just want to humble ourselves before you and tell you thank you, God, for all that you've done for us, Lord. Thank you for uniting us together as a body of Christ, Lord, by your Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for your word that leads and guides us and keeps us on the straight and narrow path, Father. May you just bless this time that we have together, Lord, as we turn our hearts to you, Father. In Jesus' name.
The Lord upholds all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look expectantly to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, gracious in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. He also will hear their cry and save them. The Lord preserves all who love him.
Will be
you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity that we have had to worship you. We thank you, Father, for the unity that we have with the body of Christ, even if we are not all able to be together. Lord, it is you that brings that unity. We are in union, worshiping you, praising you, our Heavenly Father. God, you are so good, so gracious. And we want to just praise you with all that we have and thank you for who you are with all that we have. We thank you, Father, that you look down on us. You are protecting us. You are protecting the families and each individual. And we just want to pray a special blessing, Lord God, on those that are at home, those that may be struggling, those that are having a hard time. I pray that you would be with them where they are right now. And I pray that you would soften their hearts right now in preparation for the message that is coming forth. I pray your anointing over our pastor as he brings the word. We ask, Father, for your word to go forth, that it would do what you have set it out to do, what you have called it to do. We thank you, Father, that it will return back to you and it will accomplish that which you would have it to do. We thank you, Father, for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Good morning, family. I wish everybody could be here together with us, but we're able to be with you by video and live streaming. And in a couple weeks, I pray that we're all back in the sanctuary, which will be May 24th. Until then, we'll meet with you as we can. Next Sunday, we're going to try to have another parking lot service if we don't get rained out. But I miss you, I love you, and I thank you for all the encouraging cards, the words that's been spoken. God is good. What I want to open up with is in 2 Corinthians, in chapter 1, in verse 20, it says, "For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." You know, the promise, and it only is good as the person that makes it. And God, God cannot lie. Excuse me. And God is not one that can lie. God is, when he said, gives us a promise, we have a promise. And there is a guarantee. And so what I want to share with you today, thank you, is out of Psalm 23, and we're all familiar with this psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd." Often it's used during a funeral. It's used as we're saying goodbye to somebody. But that psalm should be given to us for life. That psalm is full of promises. And so if you will turn your Bible and join me to Psalm 23, I'd like to go through that psalm with you. In Psalm 23, and I'm going to read through the whole thing. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That psalm was written by a shepherd boy. It was written by King David, but before he was king, he was a shepherd. He would take care of his father Jesse's flock. And he was a good shepherd. He understood very well what a shepherd does. He had a love for the flock, the sheep, and he protected them. He comforted them. He led them. He guided them. And what we find in this psalm is the promises of provision, the promises of protection, the promises of future hope, the promises that we can lay hold of as Christians. And so we're going to go through this verse by verse, and I want to point out the promises that we have. And the first verse, what we see is, the Lord is my shepherd. So these promises apply not to everybody, but to those that are the sheep of the shepherd. So it starts out with, this promise is for those that have become sheep, the sheep of the Lord Jesus Christ, where you have become part of his fold and his flock. And so the sheep, they can lay hold of these promises. And so the question would be, am I one of his sheep? And so let's look at that. In John chapter 10 and verse 11, it says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. And then in John chapter 10, verse 14, it says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. And so how do I know if I am his sheep? Well, number one, there's three ways to know. Number one, you know him, according to John 10:14. Number two, you know his voice, according to John 10:4. And number three, you obey his voice, which is to obey his word, in John 10:4. And so we know that we're his sheep if we know him. If we know him. John 17:3 says this, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. So this is salvation, and this is what it takes to be part of the fold and become one of his sheep, according to John 17:3. It's that you know him. Not that you know about Jesus, but you know him. You have a relationship with him. You see, Jesus Christ is not a historical figure that died 2,000 years ago and we simply read about in the history books. Jesus Christ is alive today. So that you cannot just know about him, but that you can know him because he is alive. And Jesus Christ is present among us, and he can be known by anybody. He can be known by anybody that seeks to know him. And he will not turn away anybody that wants to know him. And so this promise is for you to become one of his sheep if you're not one of his sheep, that you might know him. And the second point that I made was that you know his voice. Sheep know his voice. You recognize the voice of your shepherd. You know when Jesus is speaking. And we open up his word and we understand that in the Gospel of John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then in chapter 1, verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Well, the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Word. And so we know his voice, that when you become one of his sheep, all of a sudden the Word of God becomes living and active to you. There was a time when I did not know Jesus. I did not come to him, and I would pick up the Bible, and the Bible was Greek to me, no pun intended. But it just didn't make much sense to me. But after receiving Jesus Christ, my sins were forgiven, and I became one of his sheep. It says, my sheep will know my voice, and all of a sudden the Word of God became living and active to me. It made sense to me. It was like someone unscrambled the words. I could read it, and it made sense. That's because God has enabled you to hear the voice of his Son. And for those of you that have not received Christ, this Bible will not make sense to you until you receive Jesus. And then he will unfold and reveal the promises to you that are in this word. And I want you to know, you want to hold on to his promises. This week I just helped officiate a funeral for a young man, which is very hard to do. He was still in his 20s. And the next day, one of the parents called me and told me how much peace and how much comfort that she had received, not by my words, but by his word. These words are for life now. This word is for you to lay hold of. All the promises of God are yes and amen. Through Jesus Christ, through accepting Christ, you become one of his sheep. And by becoming one of his sheep, he becomes your shepherd. David knew very well what a shepherd did for the sheep. He protected his sheep from lions and from bears. He guided the sheep through places that were dangerous and made sure that every one of them would pass through in safety. And so when King David penned this psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd," Psalm 23, he was pulling from experience. And so this is how you know that Jesus truly is your shepherd, and you may have the benefits of being his sheep. And here are the benefits of being his sheep. One, Jesus laid down his life for you, John 10:11. You say, why is that a benefit to me that he laid down his life? Because by laying his life down, he purchased you. He bought you with his very own blood. You became his property. You may not like that in this world where we want all of our freedoms. But my friends, you want to belong to God. On the very last breath, the last day of your life, you want to know you belong to God. And so a benefit of Jesus being your shepherd, and not somebody else, but Jesus Christ and Jesus alone, is that Jesus, this shepherd, lays his life down for his sheep. He gives his life for you, that you may belong to him, and he will be your shepherd through life. He will care for you, he will protect you, he will provide for you. And the second benefit to being his sheep is that Jesus knows you. John 10:14. He says, I know my sheep and my sheep know me. It's not just that we know Jesus, but Jesus knows me. That's a benefit, my friends. If Jesus knows you, then he understands you. How many of us go through life, I wish people could understand me. I wish people understood what I have to go through. We feel like nobody understands us. That somebody we could talk to would really understand, you know, our troubles, our trials, our weaknesses, our frustrations, the things that we have to deal with. I want you to know Jesus knows you. He knows what you go through. He understands your trials. He knows your weaknesses. And despite our bad habits or some of our wrong ways, he still knows you. And he says, I'll never leave nor forsake you, because he loves you. You know, not all the sheep are perfect. We have a loving shepherd that understands that. What's important is that we follow our shepherd. So these are the benefits of being his sheep. And this was just part of verse 1. Now, if you can truly say you're his sheep and he is your shepherd, the rest of the psalm now applies to you. Amen? The last part of that verse says, after he says, the Lord is my shepherd, he says, I shall not be in want. Or King James says, I shall not want. Well, in John 4, verse 13, Jesus is speaking to a Samaritan woman at the well. And she came out to draw water. And many of us know the story. Jesus told the woman that if you drink from this well, you're just going to be thirsty again. And Jesus says, I have water that if you drink from, you'll never thirst again. That sounds kind of crazy, doesn't it? And she had to be like, well, I want some of that water. And where would you get that water? And Jesus said, you have to get that water from me. He says, everyone who drinks this water, John 4, 13, will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. And so he is saying that if you drink from me, you will not be in want. It doesn't mean that Jesus promises you that you will have everything that every rich person in this world has. He says you will not be in want. You will be content. And Paul, and the apostle, said it this way. I know what it's like to be content when I have much, and I know what it's like to be content when I have little. No matter what my circumstance, what my station in life, my age, no matter where I'm at, Jesus Christ satisfies me. I might be in sickness, I might be in health, I might be rich, I might be poor, I might be tired, I might be, you know, concerned about, you know, my loved ones, my family. But still, in all of the storms and all of the trials of life and all the circumstances that come my way, there is a contentment. I shall not be in want. Why? Because Jesus is my shepherd. You see, there are the wells of this world that do not satisfy. And Jesus was offering the Samaritan woman to drink from the well that was not of this world. The wells of this world may be the promises of wealth and the promises of money, of power and fame. The wells of this world, which many young people have drank from because of the internet, is pornography. The wells that the world has to offer is the opioids and drug abuse, alcohol. You name it, drinking from the wells of this world, trying to get rich fast, whatever the well is, it always will leave you empty. And you will not be content. These wells can be wells of discontentment, which is anger, hate, greed, and unforgiveness. This is discontentment, my friend. Someone that's content is not going to be angry, full of greed and hate and unforgiveness. When Jesus Christ comes in and satisfies your soul, you'll find yourself drinking from the wells of living water and no longer from this world. So we go on to verse 2. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. And notice what it says in this verse. Some words that I want you to pick up on. He makes me lie down. Makes. He is the Lord, and he knows what is best. And so when Jesus is your shepherd, he takes lordship over your life. And there are things that are not good for you that Jesus Christ, because he knows what is best for you, he will make you lie down. He will apply his shepherding or his lordship over you. I don't know how he will do this in your life, but at times he has made me lie down. You're running 100 miles an hour thinking you got to save the world. And then Jesus says, hey, be still and know that I'm God, not you. And he makes you lie down. My friends, we're going through a time, coronavirus. We're going through a time that many of us have been made to lie down. Enjoy the green pastures. Maybe you didn't realize that your family was green pastures. Maybe you didn't realize slowing down a little bit and opening up the Bible is green pastures. He makes us lie down. And he does this to a believer, to his sheep, throughout his whole life. He may use sickness. There's been times where you just run yourself ragged and you're just at the end and he just makes you lie down. Says, listen, you need a couple days off. Boom. You got to stay home. You need to rest. And those are times that you hear his voice. But he makes you lie down. So the second thing I want you to see is lie down. That is the rest. He's not making you run. He's not making you continue at that pace that's just going to destroy you. He wants you to rest. Rest in him. And find rest in him. And then it says in green pastures. When you look at a field that is green in the spring, how beautiful is the grass. The grass just glistens. It's such a bright green because of the cool weather and the moisture. It just thrives. And I don't know about you, but you just remember as a youth, you just wanted to roll around in that grass. There's just something about that warm sun on a cool, breezy day and that green grass, you just feel like you got to roll around in it. But green grass is a sign of life. He makes you lie down in green pastures, pastures that are full of life, places that are life. My friend, a pasture that he has prepared for us is the body of Christ. He makes us lie down, be a part of a church, settle into a body where there is life. You want to be going to a church where there is life. It's a green pasture. It's life-giving to you. It's not where you go and you get life sucked out of you. Life is given to you. It's a green pasture. There is love. There is the preaching of God's word, the nourishment of God's word. There is life. So I encourage you, if you're plugged into a good church, lie down in that pasture, rest. Don't run from church to church. But settle in. Let your roots go deep into that. If the word of God is preached, it's not compromised, and you see the fruit of the Spirit in that church, lie down. Amen. And then it says, he leads me beside still waters or quiet waters. Again, this is the shepherd's duty and responsibility to take you where you're not going to be destroyed. If you were a shepherd, you did not want to take your sheep to the rapids. You did not want to take them close to the waterfall. You did not want to take them into deep waters that is just rushing by, that would just sweep your sheep away. He says, I lead them by the still waters, the quiet waters. And I don't know if you've ever looked at a creek right after a flood. I live by Cedar Creek. And right after a couple days of rain, the creek rises. It's muddy, and it's moving along very fast. My wife and I canoed down Cedar Creek maybe a day or two after some rains. What a mistake. I wanted to turn around and get out of there because it was controlling me more than I wanted to. I had a hard time controlling the canoe. And so I wanted to get out. But after a week or so, no rain, the water settles down, the mud clears, and now the water is crystal clear, and it's not moving so fast. Matter of fact, it's gentle. And so Jesus Christ, he leads you by the clear, the still, the pure, the gentle waters. And so Jesus is a good shepherd, amen. Verse 3 says, he restores my soul. He restores my soul. Remember, you belong to him. You've been born again. You've been saved. Josh, could you bring me? I brought a couple props. And so that word, when it says restores your soul, I want you to think of yourself as a battery. Every Christian gets wore down. We get tired. And I brought this as an example. Yesterday, I was cutting through some trusses. And this is a Sawzall, and it was designed for a purpose, and it was designed to strictly cut. This blade cuts wood. And as I was cutting through some 1x8s, 1x10s, I'm sorry, 2x10s, it began to run out of power. And it just wasn't doing the job that it was designed to do. As you can see, this battery has been drawn down, and it is weak and it is tired, like many Christians. You've been designed for a purpose. I want you to know, there was a lot of thought that went into this tool, that it might help people cut through wood in some very awkward conditions and positions. Very helpful. Well, listen, you were designed by God to be very specific with your life. You need to know that in his hands, you are a tool that shall be used, and you have great purpose and reason for your life. But just like a well-designed tool, you get tired, and so did this tool. It doesn't have a lot of power. So what has to happen is this battery needs to be restored. And so you plug that battery in, as I did this battery overnight last night. This battery was restored. You plug it in, and there's all kinds of power now. Tim Taylor would like this one. But your batteries need to be restored. Every Christian grows weary. And I want you to know, it is he who restores your soul. You got to go back to the battery charger. I can't just put this battery, try to plug it into an outlet or a cell phone charger. I got to take it back to the original charger that was designed to charge this battery. I want you to know, Christian, stop looking to the world to charge your batteries. You are meant to go back to Jesus Christ. He restores your soul. So many Christians get wore out because they think that they could be restored at the movie theater, or not that anything's wrong with some enjoyment, entertainment, but I just want you to know that's not what's going to restore your soul. I happen to like a good movie once in a while. We're not legalistic. But it is Jesus that restores you. You got to plug into him. You got to let him charge your batteries. Well, Pastor, how do I do that? You know him and he knows you. You spend time with him. My personal experience for restoring my soul is I got to get out of the house and I go for walks. That's just the best way for me to recharge my battery. I don't know what yours is. Find a woods, find a creek, find a stream, find a road, find a place, find a closet, but plug in. He restores your soul. And then last part of that verse, it says, he guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. In other words, he has a lot of investment in you. He wants you to look good so that he will look good. And that's not vain. If he is the solution and the answer to all of world's problems, if he is salvation and there is no other source for eternal life, then he wants you as a Christian to reflect him. He says, he guides you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And as a Christian, are we walking in those paths of righteousness? Do we do harm for the kingdom, or do we do well for the kingdom? Yesterday, I was in a line at Home Depot. Because of social distancing, they only allow so many people in. And the line was quite long. My dad and I went to the Home Depot to pick up some lumber. And so we're standing together, and I heard someone right behind us, an older gentleman. He says, well, you can tell there's a son and a father. I must look like my dad. You know how awesome it is when someone looks at you and say, well, there's a Christian. You look like your father. It brings glory to his name. Amen. I thought, by the way, Dad, I thought that was a compliment that I look like you. In verse 4, it says, even though I walk through the valley of death, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Jesus says, in this world you will have troubles, but fear not, I have overcome the world. My friends, we will go through trials. Christians, the sheep, we will go through those valleys. And even though we walk through those valleys, we will not fear any evil. Why? Because the Bible says his rod and his staff, they comfort us. What is a rod and a staff? Well, in this, again, David knew the tools of a shepherd. He used them. David knew what a rod was. A rod was used to protect the sheep against the enemy, against critters that would devour the sheep, okay? The wolf and the bear. And so that rod was like a club. It would be used to defend the sheep. That staff was used to guide the sheep. So here we see again, even though we go through hard times in life, we're protected and we're guided through them. Amen. And we are comforted by this rod and comforted by his staff. And then verse 5, it says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What he's saying there is, Lord, you give me all I need to be respected and victorious in the face of my enemies. He prepares a table. Listen, the Bible says that he will never put to shame those that trust in him. And even though we may go through some trials and troubles, the Bible promises you victory, and even in the presence of our enemies. The last part of Verse 5 says, you anoint my head with oil. Well, to be anointed with oil, I like to go to 1 John in chapter 2 and verse 27, and I'll let you read that, but he speaks of the anointing that we receive from God, and that anointing teaches us. This is the Holy Spirit. He anoints my head with oil, meaning God anoints you, that you have the Holy Spirit as your teacher, your comforter, and your counselor. Every born-again believer in Jesus Christ has been anointed by God to hear the voice of Jesus Christ. Amen. In Zechariah 4:6, excuse me. In Zechariah 4:6, it says, "Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts." In other words, the born-again believer that's been have that anointing, where their head has been anointed with oil, that simply means this: you are a spirit-led believer. Amen. And then in verse 5, it says, "My cup overflows." Well, how does it overflow, or what with? Well, verse 6 continues to let us know. "Surely goodness and love and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And John, in chapter 14 and verse 2, Jesus says, "I go and I prepare a place for you." That's what our cup is filled up with, these promises. "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life." And when a cup is overflowing, it's more than enough for you. That means there's enough to share with others. When you have too much, meaning Jesus talks about how we will be filled with the Spirit, and that out of our belly will flow rivers of living water. That again is symbolic of this cup overflowing, where you have enough to take care of yourself and your family, and you have so much left over, you're able to help somebody else. You see, my friends, we're not to be Christians that just barely make it from Sunday to Sunday. We are to be overcomers. We are filled with the Spirit of God. That out of our belly will flow rivers of living water, that I have enough to share with somebody else. That we're not just limping into church and say, "Oh, I just barely made it this week. Okay, prop me up so I can make it to next Sunday." Sometimes we need that. But that's not the norm for a Christian. We are people to help others. Amen. And Jesus is more than enough. And our cup overflows. So this concludes this psalm. And I pray that you were blessed and that you're encouraged by God's word, because God's word is true and he cannot lie. So let's close in prayer. Father, I pray your blessings upon the body of Christ. I pray your provisions, your protection, your shepherding over the whole flock. And Lord, if there's anybody out there that's never really become your sheep, I pray that this day that they will kneel down, cry out to you, sincerely repent of their sins, ask you to forgive them. And Lord, you said that if anybody knocks, the door will be opened and you will come and you will dwell with them. I pray that there are some today that are desiring your fellowship, your forgiveness, your shepherding, your lordship in their life. And Lord, I pray that you touch them and meet them right where they're at today. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the privilege of reading your word in Jesus' name. God bless you, body of Christ. I love you. Hopefully see you soon. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. Amen.